We are representing the data science group in United Airlines. Today we'll be walking through one of the use cases that we worked in video analytics space. It's actually calculating deplaning times using deep learning. Just to give a quick introduction about the speakers, my name is Vikas Grover. I'm senior manager in data science team at United Airlines. I have a colleague with me, Jeet, who also works in the same team as analyst data scientist. Just a quick disclaimer, this is not an official position of United Airlines, so don't quote it anywhere. Really quickly talking about the agenda, we'll be starting with a quick introduction about our group. Then we'll define the problem statement, giving the complete context why this problem is important in the context of United Airlines. Then we'll talk about computer vision and deep learning concepts, which we used for solving our problem. Then at the end, we'll do a deep dive into how we approach the solution, and there's a quick demonstration of the video itself. At the end, we want to leave 10 minutes for Q&A session. I'm hoping to get a lot of questions. So at United, we are in the business of uniting the world, and we are continuously transforming United by growing our fleet and our network. Even today, we are the world's most comprehensive network, catering to 354 destinations and 48 countries. We are continuously investing in our product and in our people, and our focus areas is to provide the best experience to our customers and also run most efficient operations. So talking about the data science group, so we deal with big data. Since United Airlines is one of the biggest carriers in the world, there's a lot of data both in commercial space as well as in operation space. So we deal with cloud and edge computing software as well. Talking about the use cases, so data science group is involved in both commercial and operations use cases. So we work on optimizing the digital journey of a customer. Then we also have specific use cases in the operation world where we do predictive maintenance and make use of natural language processing and social media data. Today, we'll be talking about one specific use case in computer vision world. So let's define the problem statement. As apparent from the title of the presentation itself, we want to calculate deplaning time. But why is it a problem in first place? So let's look at the flip side of deplaning time, which is enplanement, or in simple words, onboarding time. So it's very easy to calculate enplanement time. Why is that? Every customer has got a boarding pass, and at the time of boarding, gate agent scans the boarding pass. So the total time that it takes to board the first passenger until the last passenger is called enplanement time. It's very easy. Once you scan the boarding pass, it's in the system. From system, you will know the exact view of enplanement time. But what are our options for deplaning time? One option is we can do a manual timekeeping. So we can have an agent who will start the timer as soon as the first passenger is out of the aircraft, and will stop the timer when the last passenger is out of the plane. But as you can imagine, it's not going to be efficient. It's not going to be accurate all the times. The other option is to scan the boarding pass once more, similar to what we did for calculating the boarding time. But it's not a great customer experience. And since we are a customer-facing industry, we don't want to do anything which affects the customer experience negatively. So that's why we, as a data science group, came up with this elegant solution where accurate measurement is possible. And so this is the problem statement. We are using the video feed at the gate to accurately measure deplaning time. So even now, we have the cameras installed right at the gate of all the aircraft. So we can use those video feeds to calculate deplaning time. We have defined the problem statement, but so far I haven't talked about why this is so important in United Airlines. To understand this, let's understand a concept which is specific to airlines industry called aircraft turnaround. Some of you might already know this, but for benefit of the people who are not so aware about the airlines industry, I'll explain this briefly. So United Airlines actually operate using hub and spoke model. So this is different than the point to point model that usually Indian airline carriers operate in. But since the scale is so large in United States, we can't operate in point to point model. And you can see this with the help of this diagram. So on the left side, we have hub and spoke model. So for connecting 9 points, a hub and spoke model only requires 8 routes. Whereas to connect the same 9 points, we require 28 routes in point to point model. In India, point to point model is fine since we don't have too many destinations to serve. But since United Airlines is in the business of connecting so many remote destinations, and we want to give the opportunity to our customers to connect from point A to point B, doesn't matter where those points are in United States geography. So hub and spoke model is the most efficient way to plan these routes. So now we have established that United Airlines work in a hub and spoke model. In a hub, you can imagine that there will be a lot of aircrafts going into a hub and a lot of aircrafts going out of hub. And a lot of times it will happen, the same aircraft which is coming to the hub will be required to be ready for the next departure flight. Since we have a lot more flights than the number of fleet. So the entire time that it takes for an aircraft to be ready for the next departure flight, from the time it arrives at a gate on a hub, it's called turnaround. And all the events that constitute this turnaround time are the events that have to be performed. So deplaning time is one of those initial events. If we do this quickly, then we get a heads up for rest of the events. The later events can only start when deplaning event is finished. What happens if this deplaning time is slow, or we are taking a lot of time for deplaning? As now we understand, it will affect the turnaround time of the equipment. So it can happen that your next departure flight might be delayed, and we don't want that to happen. From a customer perspective, it will be a negative impact. So if deplaning time is large, then you will be pissed off as a customer. Even if the rest of the flight is great, you won't care. And it can also impact the next departure flight. So in hub and spoke model, people have to change their aircraft to reach to their final destination. So if the connection time is really tight, so let's say you are arriving at a hub at 9 a.m. and your next flight is at 9:45. If you are not able to reach gate at time, then your next flight is missed. And as United Airlines, we'll have to make alternate arrangements for the customer. So it's an increased cost for us. So I think now you can appreciate the fact that doing deplaning in the most optimized fashion is very important to United Airlines. But we are talking about the first step in this presentation. How do we get the accurate view of deplaning time? Once we have an accurate view, we can go to the next step where we'll look to optimize this deplaning time, and we can figure out the opportunities where we have to optimize, and there can be numeric use cases, and it can have a very large impact. So in this presentation, we will be talking about how we are planning to approach getting this accurate measurement for deplaning time. And we'll be making use of computer vision concepts and deep learning concepts. So Jeet will be walking us through this journey. Over to you, Jeet. Yeah.
Thanks, Vikas, for building up the context. So let's talk about computer vision. So computer vision is all about making sense out of the visual data. That is giving computer enough ability to visualize, perceive, and gain a high level understanding of the videos and images that you'll be seeing. So before moving on, let's quickly talk about how the history for the computer vision have been for the last couple of years. So as humans, we have always tried to solve two fundamental problems in computer vision. First one being creating out the good mechanical vision, that is camera. So historically, if we go forward, go backward, then we can see the first mechanical vision was inspired out from something called as pinhole camera. And fast forward to where we are right now, we have got the cameras that can easily fit it into our pockets and we can easily record out the videos, right? Second fundamental problem is, we have got the data. How we can make sense out of this visual data? So what can be the possible applications for it? So historically, if we go backward, then we can figure out the applications can range from as simple as doing handwritten digit recognition for the zip code that was suggested by Professor Jan Likun in 1996. And fast forward to where we are right now, where there are multitude of applications in computer vision that we would be probably seeing in the next future slide. So there was something called as ImageNet movement in the computer vision industry. So this ImageNet competition was hosted by Stanford. So the high level idea was Stanford came up with a very big data set that had around 1.4 million images and around 22,000 different categories. So it was a de facto movement in the computer vision world. So a lot of different research community came up with different algorithms. So ImageNet hosted out a competition called ILSVRC, that's Image Scale Large Scale Visual Recognition Challenge. So if you can see, if we have a look at it, it was until 2012 where the drop in the error percentages was significant until 2012. And this solution was inspired from what we call as the deep neural architecture. So it's the first deep architecture that gave genesis in 2012. And it was until 2015 when we first surpassed the human level accuracy, that of 5.1%. So in 2015, we have already surpassed the human level accuracies in the image, different image analytics tasks might be image classifications, image captions, and all those things. So why are we even talking about computer vision? So there are two factors for it. This is possible because of the data that we have got and the powerful computing that we have got over there. So most of us present here are carrying a smartphone, and it would be a good that has got a 1, 2, or even 3 cameras in it. So it would be a good approximate to say that there are more number of cameras present in this conference room as compared to the total number of people, right? Apart from it, by the time I just count out to 5, there is there is already 50 GB of data that's already generated on YouTube. Just think of the enormity of the data if we include all other data sources as well. Like might be YouTube or might be Netflix and all those things. And apart from it, we have got the data. We need powerful computing. Image and video data in itself is very time consuming and it's very complex. We need a lot of compute power to actually make sense out of this. So thanks for the hardware community as well. We have got a multitude of different solutions for it. Probably we can use a CPU for a less inferencing devices to the GPU for where the inferencing cost is more to FPGA and TPU for, let's say, edge inferencing and those sort of things. So now let's quickly look at some of the very key concepts in the deep learning for video analytics. So before proceeding further, what is a video? So video is nothing but a continuously moving images. So anything that you can apply to a single, image, you can easily extrapolate that particular idea to a video, right? So you can probably dump out the frames out of the video, run out your inferencing pipeline on that particular image, and you can easily extrapolate it to the video. So anything that can be done to the image can be easily extrapolated to the video. So there is one very fundamental, visual recognition problem called image classification. So let's have a very high level idea of what it is. So let's say we have given an input labeled images of cats. We have some input labeled images of dogs. So there is some human that have marked that this particular image belongs to a cat class, this particular image belongs to the dog class. And we are passing on these images to this fancy looking neural network, what's called a deep neural network, you can probably think of. So this image is getting flown through this particular deep neural network and the neural network is learning out that, yeah, okay, I got it, it's actually a cat. The weights are going on in and the network is learning it out. So it got it that it's a cat. Okay. Let's go out for the second iteration, where we give the second image and we figure it out. We give it to the neural network, image came, come in, converted into the numbers, flown through this deep neural network architecture, and it says that it's actually a dog, but my neural network says it's actually a cat, but it isn't it, it's a dog, right? So what's happening is something called as back propagation. So the neural network is refining itself to learning out these representations and encapsulating out that this particular image belongs to the dog class. So all these different, there are some high level, computations that would be happening, and the back propagations would be happening, weight would be propagating out through this neural network, and it would be updating depending on the context. So it's learned out. Okay. So the high level idea is, if at first you don't succeed, try another billion times. This is the genesis what the image classifications and all these things work on. So like, so there are some other visual recognition problems. You have tried to encapsulate it to in the airline context, what we can probably do. So there's something called as object detection. Object detection is something where we have got a input image and we have got a multiple object in that particular image. We are actually localizing on that particular object. So let's say there is a person standing on the ground of the aircraft, so there is a person over there, there is an aircraft, there is a baggage loader. So it's uniquely identifying that this particular boarding box belongs to this particular class. There is a person class, there is an airplane class, there is a, luggage. Second is instance segmentation. So in instance segmentation, we are classifying each and every pixel in the input image to the predefined classes. So we have got three classes over here. One is a person class, one is let's say a background class, and third is let's say a airplane aircraft class. So we are pixelating and just mapping each and every pixel to that particular class. So we are saying that these particular pixels belong to a person class, these particular pixels belong to the aircraft class. Now let's look at action classification. So in action classification, what we are doing is, it's something related to object detection, but we are kind of digesting out what actually the particular object is performing in that particular image. So as you can see, as the gentleman sitting out over there is probably working out. So the network is saying that there's a person and there is a person who's working out and doing something. So it's action classification. Other problem is image capturing. So in image capturing, we are given an input image and the image is digesting out, understanding the context and giving you a story about that particular image. So there is a caption out that the model has interpreted out from that particular image. Last one is semantic segmentation. So it's somewhat related to instance segmentation. Only difference is, for the similar kind of object, it's uniquely identifying them. So there are three person class, there are three persons belonging to one class, that is person class. So it's uniquely identifying them, that there's a person on the left, that's person one, in the middle it's person two, and in the right it's person three, and there is a chair class as well. So it's uniquely identifying them as well. So in our model, we are using something called as object detection. So we are localizing out that object that are present in that particular image. So moving on to the deep learning framework and the considerations that we did have. So as you know, world is always full of choices. So we did also have this scenario where we had a lot of alternatives to figure it out, what convolution neural network we can probably go forward with. So there are a lot of considerations that you need to make up, right? So you need to worry about how, you need to take into consideration how the trade-off between speed to detect and how's the accuracy considerations as well. So you can probably come up with a complex architecture and can just throw it out for the inferencing, but it would consume resources, right? You need to worry. You need to take into consideration those factors as well. Other considerations is the resource availability. You need to take care of how's the time and money, because when you're going out for a very complex model, you would need to pay a associated cost as well. There's something called as inferencing cost, right? So you need to take into consideration those aspects as well. Other considerations are, there are a lot of pre-trained models available right now. So we have got Cafe2, we have got PyTorch, we have MXNet, Android, and others. There are a lot of different architectures that are available out in the market. You need to drill down to select out the one thing. So we move forward with selecting Cafe2. And apart from it, you need to worry about the scalability issues as well, right? So for a company like United Airlines that has got so much widespread presence, we need to take into consideration. We can come up with a, let's say, a simple solution, but we need to take into consideration how would it scale up for different hubs at different airports and all those things. So you need to take into consideration that aspect as well. So some of the possible options that we drilled down to was using RCNN, fast RCNN, faster RCNN, YOLO NSST. So there's a graph, there's a nice graph that talks about how the relation between GPU time and the overall MAC for multiple algorithms that we have got. So we want to drill down to something where we have got a model that has got a less amount of GPU time and at the same time it has got a considerable higher overall MAC. MAP is mean average precision that we're talking about. So we drill down and settling up to somewhere in SST. So here's something SST that has got a less amount of GPU time and at the same time got an overall good amount, overall considerable amount of MAP. I wouldn't say it's too much higher, but it's considerable. We can just think of this. So let's look at how's the pipeline and what are the evaluation metrics that we are using. So again, to reiterate on what Vikas said, so the deplaning time is the time difference between when the first person was detected in the frame to the last person detected in the frame. The time difference between them, that would be called as a deplaning time. So we need to take into consideration what possible gate we would be having. We have got thousands of gates. We need to drill down to one particular gate. We can probably run out the solutions and figure out how is it doing. So we need to take into consideration the homogeneous fleet aspect as well. There might be multiple fleets, there might be multiple aircraft that's coming into that particular gate that has got might be that are 180 passengers capacity, might be 250 capacities, and different aircraft that might be coming in. So we selected out a gate that serves to a homogeneous fleet. Okay, so that's an apple to apple comparison that's happening out. Apart from it, we need to take into consideration the available infrastructure as well. Nobody, if you go to the business and say that I want a high resolution camera, nobody is going to take you seriously, right? You need to figure out something where you can use your available infrastructure perfectly. So we drill down to selecting out that gate that has got the most high resolution camera and at the same time, the position of the camera was perfectly right. So there isn't any issue of just going through and manually setting up all those things. So the application uses a video source to graph frames, as I said, and DNN is being used to process all this data. OpenCV is being used to stitch out different DNNs into a single pipeline that we have built out. So right now our model is using phase detection and head pose estimation. So and it's taking care of the duplicate count when person is coming out of the plane. So there is an aircraft gate and the person is coming out of an aircraft. So our solution is detecting out the phase that there is a phase over there and it's dumping into the database, right? But when the person is going into the aircraft, there isn't any influencing since the phase isn't visible. So there are some security persons or gate agents and all those just go into the aircraft for cleanliness and all those things. We need not to worry about those things, right? We need to take into consideration passengers aspect. So since they are going into the aircraft, no phase would be detected out. So they would be kept aside from influencing out. So it would the duplicate count issue wouldn't be there. So this is a very high level overview of what our pipeline look like. So step one is frame extraction. So as I said, video is continuously moving images. So we are extracting out the frames from the video and we are using OpenCV library for extracting out the frames. Once we have the frames, we are passing on to the second module, that's the inferencing request module. So it's running deep learning algorithm to just infer out the the results. And for this, we are using CAFE2 and the deep learning framework we are using is again based on SST. Is using something called as QSNet to take into consideration the model weight files and all those things. And apart from it, for head pose estimations, we are using a CNN architecture. So once we have these results, once we have the inferencing request and we have the results, in step three, we are storing these results into the database. So we are dumping all those results at the real time into the database and we are using a visualization tool for making out the dashboard that you would be seeing. So for the database, we are using something called as GraphNA. For the database, we are using InfluxDB. And for visualization purpose, for building up the dashboards, we are using something called as GraphNA. So both of them are open source. You can probably try it out for your applications as well. It's very nice solutions to work on. So now let's quickly look at how's the evaluation matrix. So it's something different here. So there is something called as IOU. IOU is intersection over union. that is area of overlap upon area of union. So area of overlap is, let's say we have a green box that was actually a particular object that was present in that particular image. Red box is what you detected it out. So the union between those, the common area between those would be come in the numerator, and the intersection of entire area would come in the denominator. So as you can see, the poor approximation would be when we are not kind of overlapping perfectly the actual boxes. So it's a poor IOU, right? The good IOU would be when you are just trying to encapsulate, not perfectly, but it's somewhere in the between. So it's not so good, not so bad. Excellent IOU would be when you are perfectly encapsulating out that particular object in that particular image. So it's an excellent IOU. Depending on IOU, we can define TP, FP, and FN. So TP is, now here we need to take into consideration the threshold aspect. So threshold is something that you can probably play out with. It again depends on what application you are using, what application you have got, and we can change it accordingly, according to our application. So once we have the TP, FP, and FN, we can easily calculate out the precision and the recall, right? So the solution that we have built out, we tried it out on a publicly available data set called WIDER. So it's giving around 83% on the WIDER data set, and it has got a multitude amount of faces over there. But in the real time when we tested it out, it's fairly larger than this. So there are only faces that are visible on the video frame, video that we are working on. So now let's quickly look at the demonstration. So before proceeding in, let me just give you the, what you would be probably seeing out over there. So these are the frames that are extracted out from the video. So at frame 1, there was total number of people detected in the frame was 0. It goes up to till, I'm just hypothetically making it up, don't take it so much seriously. So let's say frame 110, we got a we got an event at that particular timestamp, there was a 1% detected in the frame. So it would be marked as a deplaning start event, right? Once it's keeps on happening until that point, that let's say at frame 55,000, at that particular timestamp, we got a single iteration. So this is keep on going. Let's say after this, let's say at frame 60,000, we got a 0% being detected in that particular frame. But we cannot mark it as a deplaning end event, right? Since there might be a time differences where the persons are coming out. So we would wait out for some threshold amount of time before marking it as a deplaning end event. So this threshold amount of time is defined dependent on a lot of factors, might be the fleet type you are probably serving in, and apart from the business knowledge that we have got. So this is the deplaning end event, and at this time the bridge is completely empty. So this is a video that we would be showing you in of our solutions in action. So there's an aircraft door where the camera is installed out. So the persons are coming in. As you can see, the faces are masked up for the obvious reason, since it's a PII information. So there's a bounding box detected on each and every face, and there is some text written out over there. It's called PACS captured. So the passengers is perfectly captured and stored in the database, then it would mark as that the passengers is correctly being captured out. So at the same time when the inferencing is going on, the results are being shown, dumped into the database. You can use the database for a different visualization purpose that you would be seeing. Right? So we have got the deplaning event, we have got the results. Now let's look at how the dashboard look like. So this is what we built out for our internal consumption. So it's a visualization, it's a nice visualization that you can probably see. So on the top left, there is a total number of unique passengers detected. So it's currently 72. We can encapsulate what the current gate is. So there might be multiple gates that this solution might be working on. So currently it's saying that this particular gate, this solution is running on. The next is what's the current passengers detected in that particular time stamp. So it's a real-time the statistics. So there is 1% detected at that particular timestamp. This is a deplaning status. So as you can see, the deplaning event is still going on. This green spike tells you about that. And apart from it, there is a data where we can even figure it out if there is, let's say, a crowd on the bridge. So if there is a crowd on the bridge, there would be a peak that would be happening here. And we can easily figure it out. There is some crowd and we can take up accordingly, we can just do necessary steps over there. This is the real time what we are dumping into the database. So according to the timestamp, we are dumping these number of people were detected and we are dumping into the database. And this is a kind of a historical deplaning time. So for this particular gate, what was the for that particular flight at that particular date, what was the deplaning time that it took, right? So these are all the results. So this is for our internal consumption that we are using it out. So over to you, Vikas.
So thanks for coming for the session. Before we open the floor for questions, you can reach out to us on LinkedIn. Both of us have put our LinkedIn contact here. We are actively looking out for people to join our group. So let's start the question answer session.
Nice quiz.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's again manual. Yeah, so the question is good that we have started using video analytics and deep learning in airlines industry, but for this particular use case, isn't it an overkill to utilize video feed? Can't we just use the airline agent's entry when the gate is open, when the gate is closed? Yes, you are right. So that's how it is being done currently. But again, see, it's a manual process and it is susceptible to errors. And we have seen that we can't rely on that information if we have to go about optimizing our turnaround time events. So that's a major idea. Since we already have the video feeds, why not make use of it? Yeah. So it's not like we have to come up with a new infrastructure altogether to come up with this solution.
And another suggestion is that we can use on the same analytics, you can use emotion detection maybe, and then you can categorize how they're feeling when they left the flight.
Yeah, we can do that. The only problem with that is your customers should give a buy-in. So since here, one thing to point out here is we are not storing this customer's information anywhere. We are just utilizing the frame information for calculating the deplaning time. When the first person is detected and the last person is detected. Other people have also questions. Thanks. Yeah. Good question. So the question is, did we create value out of this solution or not? So this is the first step. We have reached out to stakeholders, to hub managers, and they have liked the solution. Now the next step will be to implement it on various hubs and see it in action. So this is the first step where we have gotten a really good approach to calculate the deplaning time. Now we'll go about where we can optimize it, and essentially first we have to figure out where the opportunity areas.
So did you look at tracking people from frame to frame to further reduce your double counting?
Yeah, we are using some sort of a threshold. So we are in, let's say there are 5 frames, and let's say I'm just hypothetically making it up. In a 1 second, there is a 5 frame. So we are not probably capturing it out each and every frame. So it's after every threshold amount of time we are capturing out the frame.
So are you assigning a unique identifier to those people as they go frame
to
frame?
So the genesis is we are worried about the, what do you say, the flow of the passengers, right? So even if there are not, if you're not accurately trying to measure it out, what's the total number of persons detected or not, and there would be some duplicate count issues as well. But at the last of the day, we are only worried about the flow, right? At T to T plus 1 second, if we got the flow, that this is the flow, and at this there is a significant drop in the flow at this particular time, then we can easily encapsulate that this is a deplaning and event, right? So this is how we are approaching right now.
Do you install some specific cameras to do this task, or do you use CCTV footage or something of that?
Yeah, so this solution is actually pretty robust. It doesn't require installation of new cameras. So whatever cameras we have, CCTVs, and there are hubs where we have sophisticated cameras as well, it can utilize it. So since we are not So objective is to not calculate the number of people who are coming out. We have to calculate what's the deplaning time. So if you think about it a bit more deeply, you can say we can live with some error rate. So that's why we don't have to install sophisticated cameras.
Apart from it, there is a considerations as well, right? When the video is being captured out, there is a, let's say it's very low FPS when they are saving it out, right? If you are saving the video at a very high FPS, then there would be a significant amount of space as well, storage considerations as well.
Yeah.
So this is the beauty of the solution. So this is the beauty. We are using that particular CCTV.
So he's saying it's just ethical to use it. Yeah, so I think you have got a good question. So as I said, this is a POC. It's not implemented. I'm sure if there are considerations like that, we'll get into it. But I don't think that should be a problem since we are masking everything. So and we are only utilizing it to make our operations efficient.
Yeah, one question here. Are you differentiating between passengers and the crew? So there could be a time lag between the passengers coming out and then this crew slowly coming out a little later.
Yeah, so
how do you take care of that?
Yeah, right. So all our crew actually have a vest. So we can easily differentiate between crew and the passengers. So here we haven't done it, but that's very easy to do. So we guess for, yes,
yeah.
So like we, if we have enough videos and we will, we have got enough videos actually here. So we'll be differentiating between passengers and the crew, and that's very easy problem.
Yeah, I can continuation of the earlier question. So there could be various category of passengers like wheelchair bound and women with kids and all of that. So your basic assumption is that all passengers will take the same amount of time to come out, or how is your distribution?
No, so that's not the assumption at all. So if you see in the dashboard here, although there is no crowd here right now, but we want to track this as well, whether there is a crowd on bridge, and because it can happen that due to some considerations where the people are not moving out faster. So we want to take care of that also. So the idea here is to calculate the entire deplaning time irrespective of the distribution, whether people are moving at the same pace or they are the pace is really different. So it will be fine. We just want to detect the first person and keep detecting until there is no person in the frame. Then we'll say the deplaning time is ended.
Thank you guys.
Thank you.